Now, before I get into this topic of the API and the SDK protocols that are used by our applications, I want to try to put it into perspective. Why are we talking about this? Because we're going to spend a lot of time on this. Well, it's all in service of making it easier to configure trusts. So what's a trust, and who needs to worry about that? Well, for that, let's kind of get the big picture here. So if this is your manufacturing control network with all kinds of mission-critical, you know, servers hanging off of it, one of them, of course, is going to be PI, and that's going to be connected to your regular network, just to your general LAN, and that's where individual users are going to be sitting there with their PCs looking at applications like, oh, I don't know, how about data link? And then maybe over here you've got other clients that are running other machines, other applications like Process Book, for example. Anyway, so this is our situation. And with a situation like this, we have unattended applications that need to connect as well as these attended applications. Now, these attended applications are those things that have users associated with them. They're attended. Somebody logs in as a Windows user, and it's using the Windows integrated security, you know, this nice Windows integrated security that goes from the login here all the way through to PI, so that we know exactly what Windows user you are and we'll connect you using those credentials. That's the way most connecting clients will connect. But then we have these unattended applications. And let me picture another server here. This would be things like that OPC interface. This would be an interface node running, in this case, let's say this is running the OPC interface. Now that's an unattended application. It doesn't matter what time of day, if you have to restart the computer, you want that to start up. It's an auto start service. And so we don't typically use Windows integrated security for this machine. Now the OPC interface may not be the only thing running on there that is an unattended application. Do you remember there was a layer of software that we called the buffering layer? Buffering is something that will also start up automatically on that machine, and it's also going to need to, you know, both of them are going to need some mechanism to connect to this PI server. So how will we do that? Well, we're going to do that through a mechanism called trusts. Okay, and that's the topic of today. Today is all about trusts. And in order to explain trusts to begin with, we need to understand the difference between applications that are based on our newer protocol called the SDK and our older protocol called the API, because they have different connection credentials that they send to different servers, and we make use of those different credentials. Okay, now it's very fair to say that almost all of the interfaces that are attended that have some kind of a screen like this, this is data link, this has got, you know, a nice little table, this is process book, it's got trends, those are attended applications. Almost all of them use the newer of the two protocols. That new protocol, or the newer protocol, is known as the SDK. So I'll just mark here SDK. The SDK is what each of these are going to connect with. Now the SDK knows all about Windows integrated security, and it's through Windows integrated security that the SDK based applications are going to go ahead and connect to this PI server. Now the other applications, the unattended applications, typically those are not based on the SDK. Typically these unattended applications are built around our older protocol, and that's known as the API. API stands for the Application Programming Interface. Actually, some of these interfaces are using both the API and the SDK. And if I remember correctly, the SDK or the OPC interface is one of those. It actually makes use of both the API and the SDK. Now, how do you know which your interface is using? Well, you'll find it in the interface manual in general. And there's also some troubleshooting I can show you within the message logs that we can use for that as well. Now, there's an exception to the rule. I said most of these unattended applications are going to be using this API or the API along with the SDK. There's one unattended application that uses the SDK, and that's this buffering subsystem. Now, there is an older version of this buff server, the buffering subsystem, that is API-based. We're not talking about that in this instance. Let's discuss the newer one, the buffering subsystem. That SDK is what that buffering subsystem is based on. Now, I mention all of this because when we talk about trust, we're only talking about these applications over here, these unattended applications. It's these unattended applications that are going to be connecting using something other than the Windows Integrated Security. Now, if only our unattended applications are going to require trusts, I mean, what's the big deal? Why did I go on and on and on about these trusts? Well, it's because those trusts, when you configure them, they can be complicated because if it's an API-based application, the trust is configured one way, and if it's an SDK-based application, then the trust is configured a different way. And it all has to do with the connection credentials that are derived by the server from the connecting client. See, these are the things that are derived from the connecting client if it's API-based. We're going to derive the IP address. We're also going to derive the first four letters of the application name of that connecting client followed by the letter E. Application name is, well, that's deceptive. It's not the executable name, it's not the file name, and it's not the process name. Application name is actually the name that the developer decides to give to that application by default. Or the application name could be what you decide to configure in interface configuration utility. In fact, that's what I would recommend you do. You can stop worrying about, you know, what this application name might have been named back when we first created the interface. You can stop worrying about all of that if you just go into the interface configuration utility for that interface, like I've done here for the OPC interface, and I just go here and I specify an application name of my own choosing. There are some restrictions to that. It depends on what versions of, you know, the interface, what versions of the API you're using, etc. But in general, that's, you know, that's what we would recommend if you're having difficulty figuring out what that application name is. Now, I should point out at this point that if you don't want to rename the application name, you do have another choice. And the other choice is to just go into the System Manager message log and try to find exactly what that application is connecting as. That's something we did in an earlier video. If I simply go into System Management Tools here, this is on my interface node. Remember, I installed SMT on this node so that I could do this. If I go into Messages, here's our message logs here, and I'm going to search for, oh, let's just say for the last 5 hours, I'll search for anything that had the word, let's go with 8 hours, anything that had the word OPC in it. So what I'm doing is I'm searching for any messages from when the OPC interface tried to connect. And yes, as you can see right here, these are the connection credentials that are being passed by the OPC interface by default. So since I did not take it on myself to rename this application name, that's by default what the OPC interface connects as, this OPCP with a capital letter E. Okay, so far so good. I said you could either just use the application name that you find here in the message log, or you could specify the application name yourself. Unfortunately, when you go to do that, you'll notice this is where it gets a little complicated. If you look at the balloon help that appears, there's notice here that it looks like, depending on the version of the API, you can actually use a different number of characters. But what I'm talking about here is something that's well documented in the, if you go into the online help for interface configuration utility. Now, I found this by just searching for the word application name. Now, what this is telling us is that if you've got API version 1.6 or greater, then there's a file, pyclient.ini, that can be modified with this argument right here, those two things. If you modify that, then you have the option of setting this up to 8 characters. So instead of using just that 4 plus the E, it's simply going to be 8 characters, whatever 8 characters you put in here. So that's everything I wanted to tell you about this application name. And again, now that we know about the application name and how we're going to determine what that is, or how we can even set it if we want, you know, of course, the grand finale to this is to make use of this in this when you create a trust to allow the interface to write. Remember, this is only for unattended applications for interfaces. Now, let's return to our lecture notes here. And we had mentioned that the API-based connections use this application name, the first four characters, etc., and then we went into great detail. Now, what if you're trying to let an unattended application that is SDK-based, what if you're trying to allow that to connect using a trust? Well, that sends a slightly different set of connection credentials, IP address, of course, but we also send now, instead of the application name, we just simply send the file name of the application. So that's considerably easier, and if you're not sure what the file name is, most of the interfaces, we explain what the file name is. I'm looking at the OPC interface here. It's telling me for the buffering subsystem, it's PI/buff/SS. If you look in the buffering documentation itself, we mentioned PI/buff/SS.exe. Yeah, so if you're not sure yourself what the actual executable is for buffering or whatever application that's unattended that is SDK-based, just take a look in the documentation, see if you can find it in there. Now, finally, the SDK-based applications will pass Windows user information, the domain and the Windows user that you're currently logged in as. And that's actually how our Windows integrated security works for our SDK-based applications. So as we go through our discussion on trusts, and that's what comes next. If you look at where we are next, we're going to be discussing trusts in great detail right now. Just keep in mind that when it is time to specify this application name when you're creating the trust, you have some tools to either set the application name yourself or to go ahead and find out what it is by looking in the message logs.